We want to thank you, each of you, the residents of Hermosa, for being here and for helping coordinating this event. You were the one who put together the questions for this discussion with the candidates. You were the ones who gathered and discussed the issues on the community. You were the ones who made this happen. Thank you. A round of applause for you guys. My name is Jorge Felix. I'm an artist. I have been living on Hermosa for, it's gonna be a little over 16 years. I moved here into Hermosa and fell in love with the neighborhood. After living in Edgewater, St. Ben's, Humboldt Park, I was looking for a home and I was able to purchase a property here. I moved in here and soon I felt really welcome. But something really interesting, this is an anecdote, happened as the second day that my phone line got connected into my house. I received a phone call from a really odd that I never expected, a phone call from the office of the alderman. And I was like, how did they know that I moved here? They were welcoming into the neighborhood. They were asking me if I had my garbage can containers on the back, if they could be of any help. I was baffled, I was speechless. I never seen that type of treatment or welcoming into a community. And that was back when, before the remapping, that was a different, and I'm not saying this endorsing anybody, but it was really striking, that type of level. Hermosa is a beautiful community, full of cafes, stores, markets, small businesses, and it's really cohesive, it's really together. People have a sense of community here. And it's not full of activism, but it's really together. People walk in the street on Armitage, Fullerton, people know each other at the Walgreens. You know everybody there. It's a strong sense of community. I love that, Hermosa. But in time, things change, and the attention to the community streets and alleys declined and became even worse after the remapping of the city. Hermosa was mainly under one ward, 31st Ward. But then after the remapping, it became split in four different wards. Now we have the 26th, the 31st, the 35th, and the 36th. Now the community to demand basic services, we have to go to four different aldermen, so everybody gets the same type of kind of services. Maybe some sectors of the community, the alleys are clean, not the others. Maybe we see police security in some areas, but not in others. And we're questioning how we can make the community whole again, when we can get services all over again for the entire community. The Hermosa Community Network is a nonpartisan community group composed of concerned residents, leaders of organizations, churches, and business owners. The Hermosa Community Network was born as a response to the remapping of the community that divided the Hermosa in four different areas, affecting the quality of services and creating a lack of response to the issues affecting the community. The Hermosa Community Network seeks an open dialogue tonight that will educate the local residents and candidates about the needs of the Hermosa community. The Hermosa Community Network developed the United Hermosa Candidates Discussion, this event tonight, as a nonpartisan open forum to address issues affecting the residents of the Hermosa community. Members of the Hermosa Network met and conducted several exercises. We asked between ourselves, what are the issues that are more important to you, that are affecting you directly on your home, on your business, on your organization? We did several exercises, several meetings, and from those meetings and those issues concerned, we developed eight questions that are gonna be addressed to the candidates tonight. Now to move this forward, and now that you understand how this event came together, let's introduce the candidates. And this is really unprecedented. In a community in Hermosa, we never thought that we were gonna have 13 candidates, but this is what we have on Hermosa. And this is why have been a lot of confusion. On my blog, a lot of people ask me where we are, who is my candidate? And they see signs, 13 different signs around, and people don't know who is my candidate. So we have them from the 26th ward, Adam Corona.
How you doing? My name is Adam Corona. I just want to say thank you to each and every one of you for being here tonight, taking some of your time off. Instead of being with your family, you're here with us to listen to our platform. Thank you to all the candidates. My name is Adam Corona, and I'm running for the 26th ward.
We have Juanita Rizzari.
Good evening, everybody. Again, thank you so much. Sorry to all those who really can't see in the back, but hopefully we'll be able to have a good dialogue nonetheless.
We have the alderman of the 26th ward, Roberto Maldonado.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here this evening. I'm very excited to be here and looking forward as your next alderman to serve the portions of Hermosa that is part of the 26th ward.
We have the alderman of the 31st ward, Alderman Roy Suarez.
Good evening. Thank you for being here. It's really nice. Looking forward to the debate, and we're looking forward to being reelected as your alderman in the 31st ward.
We have from the ward of the 31st ward the candidate Sean Starr.
Yeah, hi. My name is Sean Starr. I'm running in the 31st ward. I also would like to thank all of you for coming out. It's nothing like warm bodies and some political spirit to fill a room on a cold winter's night. We appreciate everyone being here, and I'm looking forward to meeting you after our presentation. Thanks.
We have a candidate for the 31st ward, Millie Santiago.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you. Thank you also for being here. Your presence means that you are very interested in the future of the four wards. So thank you so much for being here, and we look forward to a great conversation rather than a debate.
We have the alderman of the 35th ward, Roy Colon.
Thank you. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here, and it's also an honor and a pleasure to have Hermosa being part of the new 35th ward. So I'm looking forward to a very spirited conversation this evening.
We have a candidate for the running for the 35th ward, Carlos Rosa.
Buenas, yo me llamo Carlos Ramirez Rosa. Soy candidato para concejal aquí en el distrito 35. My name is Carlos Ramirez Rosa, and I'm a candidate for alderman here in the 35th ward. And thank you so much for joining us tonight, and thank you so much to the residents of Hermosa for putting this together.
Now we move to the 36th ward, and we have Alonso Zaragoza.
Hi, my name is Alonso Zaragoza. I'm running the 36th ward. I'm an independent candidate here in the race, not connected to any machine. I just wanted to thank Jorge for all the work that he's done. This was not an easy thing to put together. I'm aware of what you've done here, and I appreciate it. So thank you so much.
Thank you. And we have Christopher Vittorio for the 36th ward.
Yes, my name is Chris Vittorio. Thank you for coming out. This is very encouraging to see this many people. This is by far the biggest turnout I think we've experienced. Although 36 is just a small portion of Hermosa, I'm glad that it is included, and this is very encouraging. So thank you for the opportunity.
We have Gil Villegas for the 36th ward.
Yeah, how you doing? Gilbert Villegas running for the new 36th ward. I wanna thank everyone for coming out this evening. This is what democracy is about. I'm glad that you guys took time to leave your home and come out here and hear what the candidates have to say. But I would be remiss if I didn't say that in the 36th ward, just last night, there was a fatality that occurred. And I wanted to, you know, quickly give a moment of silence to that family that lost that 13-year-old kid. So. Thank you.
And we have Omar Aquino for the 36th Ward.
Yeah. I just want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. It's re-encouraging to see so many community members in the area, in Hermosa specifically, that want to be engaged with the community. It's great to see all the candidates here showing the importance that Hermosa is in the city of Chicago. So thank you.
Thank you. We are missing on the panel Irma Cornier. She's running on the 31st Ward, and she she's in a family vigil. That's something that precluded her from coming in, but we are in our thoughts and prayer with her family there. Before we move forward to the questions, we want to state that the Hermosa Community Network does not endorse any candidates and promotes an open dialogue between residents and candidates. For this reason, we expect the following. We will not tolerate signs, materials in these premises. We will ask you to remain silent so everybody can hear the questions and refrain from yelling, make interruptions during the candidate's statements. If not, you will be asked to step out. After the third round of statements, there will be time for you to come and ask questions directly to the candidates. We are trying to move this as quick as possible because we would like to see the interaction of the people apart from these 8 questions. That if you have anything to ask directly to any of the candidates, you can come to the table and talk to them directly. At that moment, if you want to share information, campaign materials, you're welcome to do that at that point. That's after, and this is not a debate. We're gonna be having a conversation, and we're gonna be asking questions. We don't expect back and forth, nothing. We just want to hear some answers from each of you. The Hermosa Community Network discussion will be moderated por este servidor. Each ward will be presented with 2 rounds of questions. The same question to each candidate. And the candidate will have 90 seconds to answer. There will be a timekeeper. We have here, Jesus. Oh, Brian, I'm sorry. Jesus is asking the question. Brian is gonna be the timekeeper here. And we have a really interesting device built by Fernando. Where is Fernando? Oh, back here. You will see 3 lights here, green, yellow, and red. When you see the yellow, that means that you have 30 seconds left, 20 seconds left. When you see the red light, you have to stop, okay? Let's respect each other's time. There are 13 candidates. We want to move these along. We want to get out of here no later than 8:30, okay? And when asked the question, the candidate can opt to respond seated or stand up on the chair. After the second round, the question, there will be an open round. I explained that already. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to make a final statement or address anything that you cannot, that you heard in another question that was not posed to you. As I explained, the question is gonna go directly to each specific ward. But if you hear something that is relevant to you, on this third round, you will be able to talk about that or just make a final statement in general. After the third round, then I will be open for the public to come in and the forum will be completed. In saying this, we have a series of questions created by several volunteers from the Hermosa Community Network. Here with me. And the first one question is coming from Gloria Quintana.
Hello, and thank you for coming. My name is Gloria Quintana, and I live by Armitage and Kilpatrick Avenue. This question goes to the alderman and candidates for the 26th Ward. regarding the issue of business development. Hermosa has a long history of business development. Small businesses has lined up the Diversey, Fullerton, and North Avenue corridors since the late 1800s. Now local businesses have to compete with two Walmarts within the boundaries of Hermosa. This past December, the Hermosa Network met with the city treasurer, Kurt Summers, who expressed the interest of the city treasury in investing in local businesses, as well as to influence and engage banks and financial institutions in local communities. How would you work with the local residents, business owners, and city treasurer's office to ensure the growth of existing small businesses in the area, especially independent businesses, as opposed to chain businesses, Walmarts, and other mega stores coming from outside the community? Yes.
Hello, hello. First of all, that's a great question. I'm opposed to one of those big box stores. Why? Because I was a small business owner for 6 years. I was a small business for 6 years, and I know what it takes to bring small businesses into the community. We got to look into, first of all, if we got in those TIF districts, if we can get some of this BIF money to help those small businesses. Also, we have to bring different institutions like banks. Banks are required to reinvest back into our community. A lot of people don't know about it. And it's an alderman, if I come to be the alderman 26th ward, that's I can guarantee you that I'm gonna bring some of those workshops, some of those entities to see how we can get help from this, you know, from banks, it's BIF money or TIF money. Like I said, we also need promotion. We need to promote these small businesses. We need communication from the alderman's office that every time there is a new business in our community, everybody needs to know so we can continue supporting more businesses. We need a strong chambers of commerce in our community to attract more businesses. And this is something that we don't have at this time. So by creating strong chambers of commerce, we attracted more businesses and we can continue promoting. We got to reach outside this world, not only with the residents, we got to keep promoting and trying to communicate and tell people from other parts of the world that they are welcome into our community. And also, I think that is part of the safety issue that affects a lot of our community, the people still not feeling safe to invest back into our community. This is something that we have to work. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I think even if I stand up, I'm still not tall enough for you to see me, but I will. I say it all the time. It's a fact of life for me. Thank you again for this opportunity. This is a really exciting question for me, not just about the issue of small businesses, but also about the process of community planning. I come out of a background of urban planning. I studied that in graduate school, but more importantly, I was involved for many, many years in Humble Park in a group called the Humble Park Empowerment Partnership, where we brought community residents together across many different groups, from churches, block clubs, small businesses, nonprofit organizations, and then representatives from government to develop plans for the community and to pursue those plans. And so first of all, I would want to engage you as community residents to develop a community plan for the Armitage Quarter, Fullerton Quarters, North Avenue, wherever the appropriate places where we need to emphasize as a community. So for me, that would need to come from you. One of the other things I would be excited to bring to the table is I used to run a small business development program for small businesses. In this case, it was particularly based in Pilsen, but we worked with a revolving loan fund to provide loan programs for small businesses. And a lot of the times we did not have those technical assistance that those businesses needed in order to even apply for small business loans because they didn't have the formal bookkeeping and things like that. So I would be really excited to look at what the technical assistance might be that we need to bring to small businesses. And let me just say, I'm an anti-Walmart person all the way, and I really want to see our local businesses engaging with the community rather than selling out the community to the big box stores. Thank you.
Good evening, and I do also welcome this question. One of the things that the city does have are the microloans. The microloans are through the City of Chicago and the City Treasurer. that started 2 years ago aggressively has helped a number of businesses throughout the city. That is the type of programs that we need to promote along Armitage, although the 26th Ward goes just up to Karloff, not all the way to Kilpatrick. But nonetheless, this is an opportunity and a program that is underutilized here. It is underutilized here in the Armitage corridor. The other thing is, you know, we are part of a TIF, so and under the TIF, you know, the Armitage Milwaukee TIF includes this part of Armitage, and the SPIF program is a great program in which truly small business owners get true free money. It's for $1 that they invest, they get $1 back in a rebate, and that's a very powerful program that has been used in other parts of the ward. I do want to announce that in this year, the next couple of months, there is a new beer brewing company that is opening up on McLean, and I'm sorry, McLean and Pulaski, and a Dunkin' Donuts too.
Okay, thank you. Let's remind the people to respect the process, remain quiet. If you see somebody that is disrupting, help us maintain the order and escort the person outside. The question number two is coming from Carmen Peralta.
Hi, I'm Carmen Peralta. And this question goes for the candidates of the 31st Ward. I live in an apartment. I live in an apartment at Fullerton and Kenneth. Our building and the building across the street have always been owned by the same people. There are 30 apartments in the two buildings. Private rents, not subsidized. Last January, a new owner bought our building, but never said anything to us. Then in September, every single apartment got a notice that we all had to leave by the 31st of October. The new owner started rehabbing the apartments as the tenants moved out. We formed the Tenants Association and hired an attorney. And we have been able to stay as late as March 31st. But what if this starts happening in lots of other buildings, which is happening in a lot of other buildings? Several of us, including myself, are trying really hard to stay in this community. But me and my daughter are having a very difficult time finding affordable housing in this area. As aldermen, how will you protect tenants when entire buildings are emptied out? And how will you create affordable housing in Hermosa for families like mine?
My turn. Thank you. Nice, cool, good question. First of all, I want to let you know that John McDermott from Logan Square Association has informed. Before I walked in here, that they settled the problem that the building where you were living in terms of the Logan Square City Board Association and the lawyers got together and they got a deal cut today. They finished the deal. But in terms of finding affordable housing, we got to build more affordable housing. But we can also have these people that buy buildings. We have rules in the city of Chicago. They just can't come in here and give you a notice and ask you to move. If they do that, they have to pay it. Moving fees and so forth. So anytime a new owner comes to a building your size, any size, they cannot just ask you to leave. That's those rules we voted for. As a matter of fact, we did a tenants ordinance this past year in regarding to abuse by so many of these landlords that come in and they think they can just throw you out. That's stop and it's gonna stop. I don't allow anybody to abuse people. And we will work with you and LSNA and anybody else who has a problem to make sure that these don't happen. In terms of providing housing, sure, we have to find people, developers, that are willing to come in and build, and I am open. Right now, we're gonna be building affordable housing over here on behind the McDonald's for seniors again. We're gonna build the first senior and veterans housing and affordable houses, and I am looking also to find some property.
Hi, yeah, thanks for the question. It's a very good question. I've made a commitment to keeping affordable housing as part of the 31st Ward, one of my four main platform points. I found it curious that it's actually the point that I've gotten the most backlash from the community. It's my opinion that if you're not able to stabilize and keep your community together, you don't have a community in the first place. And displacing residents is something that I think ruins neighborhoods and ruins families and ruins communities. So I'm a big advocate of affordable housing. Alderman Suarez voted against the affordable housing promise ordinance, which would have provided more oversight over the Chicago Housing Association. The Chicago Housing Association is sitting on a surplus of $432 million that it's not using. It gets federal money from the federal government for the spend on affordable housing in the city of Chicago, and it doesn't use all the vouchers it gets. So it has it's one of the few organizations that has this surplus of money. So if I'm elected alderman, one of the things that I'm gonna be a big advocate for is more oversight in the CHA and usage of those funds. I'm a strong advocate for one-for-one exchange. So if you're a developer and you wanna come in and tear down something, it has affordable housing, you've got to find out another place in the ward to build affordable housing. I also advocate mixed income living. I grew up in a mixed income home from the standpoint that, thank you.
That is an excellent question. And I've been knocking on doors for about 5 or 6 months now. That has been one of the questions that have been addressed by a lot of residents. I believe that when a project comes to the ward, especially on housing, people should know what's coming. People should know about it. I believe that if the vice mayor is the chairman of the housing committee, he should be more aware of what these issues are and what's going on, and particular buildings like the one you are mentioning. I will try to fight hard to make sure that these landlords and these big owners of these buildings are accountable and are responsible, and whenever they are doing a certain project or selling the properties and displacing tenants, you know, the aldermen should know about it, the community should know about it, and there should be something done about it. One of the things that I really wanted to try to do is to defend the middle class, low income people, especially people who have children attending public schools in the ward, so that they do not get displaced. I will make sure that everybody gets a fair share and that our communities continue to live in this ward, because we want to make sure that this continues to be a ward for all. And I'm going to stop before I get a red light because I don't want to get a ticket.
Thank you. Now we're moving to the 35th ward. And we're gonna have Maritza Nazario from En Las Tablas.
I'm short too, like Juanita. well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for being here. On behalf of En Las Tablas, I wanna welcome, and I hope to see you, some of you here for classes in the future. This question goes to the candidates of the 35th Ward. I moved here after 20 years living in Wicker Park, when Wicker Park was a very tight community, but we know, all of us know what happened to Wicker Park because of gentrification. That sense of community was lost, and I went looking for a neighborhood where I felt that I can grow roots and I felt connected. And I came here by choice. I decided to come here to Hermosa. So I bought this building, and we opened this organization about 8 years ago. So I found that sense of community in here, and I am very excited to be part of this community. But with the remapping, that sense of community, I feel, is a little threatened, because now things that, as a community, we can go to mainly one alderman, now it has to be divided among four aldermen, making it a little bit difficult, because I can talk to my neighbors here on Karlov, and it's a different person, but I'm half a block here, and it's a totally different person. And then there is the perhaps a little, no competition, but perhaps some people are gonna get services faster than others, and that create sometimes a sense of why some people might get them faster than us. So how do you propose of keeping communication open between your office and the three other aldermen that also share this neighborhood? And how would you make sure that Hermosa South, North, West, and East are going to receive the same quality of services, and some of the areas are not going to get better or worse services than the other areas?
Thank you. Great question. You know, one of the things that I've been able to do in having the 35th Ward with the Logan Square is working closely with the neighboring aldermen. Logan Square now has several aldermen, but when I first was elected, we had three. So I had to work with the 1st Ward, and I had to work with the 26th Ward, and use menu dollars for different infrastructure. So, you know, part of the way that I keep communication open with the neighborhood, like tonight I was a little bit late because we have ward night every Monday night. So it's an opportunity for the residents directly to see me on a first come, first serve basis whenever they want to deal with their specific issues. But also it's important that, you know, if you have multiple aldermen in one community, you should be getting more services, not less, because all of us have $1.3 million in menu dollars that we can invest for speed humps, for new lights, for new sidewalks, for traffic signals, and all of those infrastructure things, sewer repairs. So it's really important that you have an alderman that's willing to work with their neighboring alderman to bring resources into the neighborhood and not having less. And that's the same thing when it comes to police response. We may have the situation that happened here in the 36th Ward, but we're all affected by what happened with this young man in Belmont Cragen. And so it's really important that, you know, we're also involved in our local policing and keeping our neighborhood safe. Also integrating arts and business in the community so that there's a high level of communication, that we're not, you know, splitting between this side of the street or that side of the street. We're all paid by city dollars, and we should all be providing you service no matter what ward you live in.
Muchísimas gracias, Maritza, y gracias por abrir este espacio, las tablas, a este foro comunitario. La pregunta fue, ¿cómo es que vamos a asegurar que con cuatro distritos, con tantos concejales, vamos a tener servicios aquí en nuestra comunidad, y cómo es que vamos a tener ese sentimiento de tener una comunidad aquí en Hermosa? Y yo he estado tocando muchas puertas desde el verano. He tocado más de 2,000 puertas aquí en este barrio, y no voy a dejar de tocar puertas cuando soy concejal, porque yo creo que es muy importante poder ver con tus propios ojos lo que está sucediendo en nuestros barrios. Y lo que yo he visto y lo que yo he oído es que en este barrio no están recibiendo los servicios que merecen. Todos pagamos impuestos, todos somos dueños de propiedad, pero aún aquí he visto más pajos, no sé cómo se dice pajos en español, he visto más pajos, he visto más ratas, he visto tantos asuntos. Mi compromiso es a las familias de este barrio para asegurar que tienen alguien que está a su lado luchando y diciendo, es hora de invertir el 8.9 billones de dólares en nuestra cuenta pública de la ciudad en este barrio aquí, porque lo merecemos. So, my name is Carlos, I'm running for Alderman 35th Ward, and what I wanted to say is that I want to make sure that you have an alderman that's knocking doors year-round, that's talking to residents, that's figuring out what's going on in your neighborhood, and then is standing up and saying, invest the $8.9 billion in City Hall in our neighborhoods right here. And whoever is alderman, whoever is elected, I'm going to work with them all the time, right? I'm going to get coffee with them, I'm going to sit down with them, I'm going to build those partnerships, right, with my members of the fellow members of City Council, but especially with you, the residents, because that's who I work for.
Now we're moving to question number four. And we're going to have Ivan Gonzalez.
Good evening, candidates. My name is Ivan Gonzalez, and I live close to the corner of Costner and Fullerton. I've been in the Hermosa community almost 25 years. Raised my two sons there and five granddaughters currently. This question has to do with educational options. If we look at all of our high schools in your ward, and we look at the number of young people walking around with ROTC uniforms, and wondering, what other options do kids have in high school? What will you do to support both the opportunity to have more options at high school and to increase the amount of money that would come into the community for arts and cultural organizations to preserve our culture?
This goes to the 36th
ward.
All right, thank you so much. There's nothing in this community for young adults. There's no community center, there's no indoor soccer field, there's nothing for people under the age of 25. You know, and then we're wondering why there's so much violence in our community, right? They have nothing to do. They're turning to themselves for entertainment as opposed to organized sports and organized art projects that exist in other communities, but we just don't have that here. So why is it that Lincoln Park, you know, and Bucktown have places for young adults to go to, but Hermosa doesn't? Right, I was born and raised over by Laramie and Fullerton by Black Hawk Park. I started organizing in Black Hawk Park at the age of 15 because of an alderman who took down my my basketball courts. Mm. Right, won't say his name, but he's present. Right, I didn't have anything to do. All I had were those was that park, and when they took that away, they took everything that I had at that age. You know, and I was lucky enough to go to school, and my parents were supportive of me, and that's why I didn't turn to violence or to gangs. But other children don't have those options, right? So I'm going to do whatever it takes to make sure that we get funding and make sure that the young adults in this area are not ignored, because I've heard a lot of stuff about, you know, we're going to bring funding for seniors, but I've not, in any of the debates, have I heard anybody other than myself talk about what is needed for young adults, right? We complain about them, but we don't offer solutions that are going to get them to not cause violence.
Along the lines of what Alonzo said, I think two problems we face with education, kids that underperform, and then in our communities, especially like Hermosa, those that do perform well don't have too many options. So priority number one, I talked about this at length on my website, I strongly believe in mentoring. Those kids that are falling behind really need some positive mentors. I plan to implement this in the 36th ward at each of our schools. Sorry, I have no room to stand here. schools, public libraries, I envision a true after-school program that are going to keep these kids off the street, keep them engaged, get them active in their studies. I also would love, and this works along with all the other aldermen of our neighboring wards, I'd like to see more options in the form of a magnet school in this part of the area. Kids need more options. I also am a firm believer in training in the trades. Technology is key. You see this new development that we have. Why can't we bring more things like that into Hermosa or any of these parts? Our kids need options, and like you said, it's not just ROTC. So priority number one, we need to make sure those that are falling behind have the mentoring and the help that they need, and then our kids that are performing need to have more options.
Good evening. Three high schools in the 36th ward, Stymus College Prep, Prosser Vocational School, and then Chicago Academy School. And so I think that we need to take a look and realize that not all children, not all of our children are going to college. And so Prosser Vocational School is something that I really want to focus on. I was endorsed by the Chicago Federation of Labor and have begun discussions with them to talk about bringing the building trades to Prosser Vocational School to talk about electricians, union iron workers, operating engineers. As a former chief of staff at the Capital Development Board, I had the opportunity to see that there was a lot of people working union workers working on these projects. However, a lot of them did not look like us. They were not in the skilled trades. A lot of Latinos in laborers, but not in the skilled trades. I think we need to focus on Prosser Vocational, making sure that we put a curriculum together that the unions put together for us, and then they recognize once that child has graduated from high school that it's similar to a pre-apprenticeship program. Those trades pay $30 to $40 an hour, and those are the type of jobs that we need in the 36th Ward. College prep, we want to make sure that we're preparing those kids to college. But then again, we understand that in the General Assembly, they eliminated the scholarship program. And so what I propose to do with Alderman is to donate a portion of my salary to create what's called the 36th Ward Scholarship Foundation. And only the kids from the 36th Ward that want to go on to college will be eligible to participate and try to get those scholarships. Again, we have some great high schools there, but we need to make sure that we're investing. Excuse me.
Mr. Gonzalez, I appreciate your question. I think it's an important one in our community right now. I'm actually a product of CPS, of high school, of Lincoln Park High School. I ended up going to Lincoln Park even though I lived in the Galewood community because I was accepted to an honors program out there. But little did I know until I got into college that my neighborhood school actually offered those similar programs. And so we want to make sure that we are making aware to our community members the options that our local neighborhood school have, but also that we're funding them correctly. In addition to that, I'm in agreement with some of the candidates here that we want to have after-school programs at the schools, at parks, so that they can be act as community centers, but we need better parks. We, right now, a lot of the parks in our community, you know, it's not safe playing grounds for our kids. And so we need to make sure that there's a lot of things that go into sort of, you know, these questions, education, employment opportunities, and public safety. These all intertwine together. But lastly, I would be looking out to speak with the community, work with stakeholders like yourself, involve parents that are concerned about the education. One of the first few things that I'm gonna do as alderman is create advisory committees. Education's gonna be one of them. I'm hoping to have teachers there, members of the community like yourself, so that we are talking as a community of saying what we should be advocating for and bringing those resources and services to our community. Thank you.
Well, we completed the first round, and we're going to be moving immediately to the second. I fail to say that we have two translators. If you need assistance in Spanish, if you're, we have two translators, and they're going to be on the back table. Go over there. We have Gloria and another. I know that we have another volunteer that is acting as a translator, and he will be in the back. He will be able to help you. Okay, and now we're gonna be. Oh yes, of course. Si necesitas traducción al inglés al español. Tenemos dos traductores. Tenemos dos personas. Gloria. ¿Solamente uno? Ok. Gloria está disponible y te pueden ayudar a entender las preguntas y también las respuestas. Ve a la mesa de atrás y te podrán asistir con las traducciones. Ok. Ve una mano allá, así que se pueden mover hacia the front table, on the door. Ok. Ok, now we're going to break the rhythm here and we're going to go to the 35th ward. And we're going to have Fernando Fuentes. Our electrical engineer.
Good evening. My name is Fernando Fuentes. I live here in Palmer and Karlov, like 10 years. And my question is about the security and lack of police response. In the last 4 to 6 years, Hermosa residents have noticed a considerable increase in gang activity and the tagging of residences, home garages, and businesses. Members of the Hermosa Network have expressed, me, one of them, frustration with the response of the police to residents' calls and the dysfunctions of the CAPS meetings. And the other thing is there is a problem in the schedule, because we have some young people taking drugs in the school, okay? But when you go to the school, it's after school, so it's not my problem. And when you go to the police, they say it's in the school, so it's CPS problem. So residents notice on foot and bike, police presence along Fullerton Avenue near the alderman's office, which is great, but also notice that there is no police presence along Diversity, Armitage, and North Avenue's businesses corridors. How will you work along other aldermen to ensure there is police, foot, and bike police patrol in all of our business corridors and other key areas? How will you improve the response of police to the area?
Thank you very much. You know, one of the areas that I've been successful in the 35th Ward is to reduce crime in the neighborhood. In fact, it's gone down by like 25%. But most of it was not because of the police. It was with organizing the people that live on the blocks by block basis. And one of the things that we've been working on in my office and will continue to do in the new 35th Ward is to try to get neighbors to know each other, try to get neighbors to know the names of the children on their block. When you build relationships on the block, you're gonna get a lot better police response because you're gonna have a more organized citizenry. And so what we work on doing really is starting the first level is to have block parties and try to get as many people to organize a block party on their block and eventually form like a block club. And then work on getting, whenever somebody sees a crime, get them to report it to the police. One of the things that happens a lot is people report crime, they bring a crime incident to the alderman's office, and then we do calls for service and find out that nobody's called the police. And sometimes it's because people are maybe not citizens and they're afraid to get involved in the community. And so it's really important that we work as aldermen to make sure that we reach out to everybody to make them part of the life of the community. And when we get more people involved in calling, then we can prove to police that we need more response, more squad cars, more police lights, or any of the other amenities that come with coming in the neighborhood. So the first thing we have to do is organize our neighbors to be active. Thank you.
Thank you for your question, Fernando. I've knocked a lot of doors in Hermosa, and whenever I'm done having a really fruitful and interesting conversation, they always say, be careful out there. So these issues of crime are very serious, and it was some years ago when I was actually knocking for another candidate that I myself was a victim of assault. So crime affects us all and it touches us all the time. And I think that one of the first places that we can start is by making sure that we have a representative or the alderman himself at every single CAPS meeting. So that's the first thing that I'm gonna do as alderman, right, is to make sure that we fill that gap and that at every single CAPS meeting, either myself or someone from my office is there. The other thing that I'm gonna do is I'm gonna stand up and say, we need 1,000 more police officers on our streets. You know, my aunt and uncle, they're police officers. They make a lot of money on overtime. And I don't wanna knock them on making overtime, but I think it's foolish that every single year we're spending $100 million paying out overtime. I think that money would be better spent making sure that we have police officers that are really getting to know our blocks, right? That are really doing that that beat policing. You know, getting to know the mothers, the fathers, the institutions. And then the other thing I'm gonna do is I think that we need to uplift our youth, right? So I'm gonna support community schools. So that issue that you talked about the schools saying, oh, we're closed, that's not our problem. I'm gonna say, let's make our community schools places where children can access after school activities. That's gonna take money. And that's why I'm saying stop the corporate handouts, close the corporate tax loopholes. It's time to invest in our children and our neighborhoods first. And that's exactly what I'm gonna do as alderman. Thank you.
Now we're moving to the 36th Ward, and we have Mary Ellen Proto.
Hello, everyone. I have a building down the street, Art on Armitage. I'm an artist, and I also have work in the window of artists from around the world to next door. anyway. I moved here 15 years ago. I spent 20 years in Avondale, and then I moved to here, and I really like the building, and I love the neighborhood. I love that it's a family-oriented neighborhood, that there's children out on the streets, but it is dirty, and it's dirty, and it's gotten dirtier. They took all the cans. There was one on every corner on this street after the streetscaping in the 90s. There was one on every single corner. And then about after the second remap, they were all disappeared. They all disappeared. And then they put a couple of baskets, you know, the ones that the air can just blow through and blow the garbage back out on the street. And every time I would complain to the alderman, it was, oh, that's a dirty neighborhood. Well, yeah, you took all the cans away. Okay? So we have some real serious concerns about city services here. Primary is sanitation. I've lost two garbage cans. I can't get them. A year. I can't get the garbage cans. That's ridiculous. You know, I could always get them before. What is it? All right. Street cleaning, three times a year maybe? Three times? Maybe. Right? There were leaves across the street that had been there from the year before. We got parking problems because the meters, thank you very much, but all of the blocks have turned into private parking areas for the residents. There's nobody who works on this street. They can't park anywhere. There's no place for them to park. So there's fighting over these few parking spaces that are available. I mean, these are all city service problems that are not being addressed by the aldermen or by anyone. So semi-trucks are going down our streets, you know? They shouldn't be going down the streets. So I'd like to know what you are going to do. Now, I know I'm addressing this to the 36, but I'd like you all to think about it, please. How you would get together and how you would get these city services, equal proportion to all of Hermosa and equal to all the other parts of your ward that are not in Hermosa. We want you to spend an equal portion. So how would you do that?
So I'm not going to say this is a dirty neighborhood because this is my neighborhood, right? I don't live that far away from here, and I have seen the same changes in city services that you have. If you go over by Armitage and Cicero, it's just messy, you know? And when the city doesn't do anything to clean up the properties or the streets, the residents feel like, well, if the city, you know, doesn't do it, we're not going to do it either. And you know what? We have to start holding our, not just our elected officials and our politicians accountable, but also the people who work for them, streets and sands. They need to do their job and clean up and make sure that our streets are safe. Minimum that they should do that. As far as parking meters are concerned, I was the president of the IVIPO, and we were one of the first organizations to file a lawsuit against the city of Chicago to overturn the parking meter contract, but some of the incumbents here renewed the contract and made it even worse, right? So in other communities, they use TIF money and they use other funding to pay for some of the parking meters on specific days just to help out the businesses, because I mean, I gotta pay $3 or $4 an hour to buy a $5 torta in this neighborhood? Like, right? I'm gonna go to Elmwood Park. This is not right. I don't think these incumbents, these machine politicians are doing what's best for their pockets. They're not doing what's best for the residents of this ward. As far as distribution of resources, I'm gonna make sure that everything is fair. Because some of these politicians, if elected, they're going to put the money where the voters are. And our community, unfortunately, doesn't vote very much. We need to spread everything and make everything fair and equal for everyone.
Yeah, along the lines with what Alonzo said and why we're all here and concerned tonight, the biggest problem we face is the corruption down at City Hall. I don't think there's many people in this room that would argue that the remapping was done for your benefit, for the benefit of the residents. This remapping was done, particularly in my ward, to create a better voting pool for certain candidates. And it split up a great community, Hermosa. This is the biggest problem we face. In my particular ward in 36, we are lacking city services across the board. Our streets are looking really bad, and that's because no one really knows who's supposed to service us. We have an alderman that moved to another ward, and his focus, I believe, is in another area. We have other aldermen that have, you know, part of their old ward went into our new 36, so they're not too concerned because they are going to be servicing a new ward. This is the biggest problem we face, and it's one of the biggest motivators for me to get involved in this race. We need true independent voices, and my objective is clear. I am going to be an independent voice for the 36th ward, and I am going to bring some common sense and some reality to the fantasy land that is City Hall.
36 Ward residents, help's on the way. Help's on the way. I could say that as it relates to city services, I've already processed over 300 service requests for my volunteers. I'm already doing that. It's not something that I want to do. It's something that I've done. As it relates to city services, we're going to implement what's called participatory budgeting. What that means, that allows the community to understand that 1.3 million of that menu money for infrastructure projects, a million of those dollars will be decided by the community what's best, which projects to pick, right? So we'll have a committee formed to talk about and identify these projects. And not just me, not the alderman, the community is going to decide how to spend $1 million, which projects are most important to them. As it relates to crime, I mean, we're talking about issues with crime. Over 1,500, I put out over 1,500 we call police signs. We've got to get the community engaged. We got to get the community engaged. Listen, I'm the only progressive candidate here that's worked closely with Nick Sposato to bring resources to the parks. So again, don't be fooled by some of these candidates that are talking about independence and stuff like that. The reality is that you got to work closely with all your elected officials to bring resources at the federal level, the state level, the county level. Because again, if elected alderman in the 36th Ward, that's who I work for. I'm going to bring the resources from every level to the 36th Ward. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. The reason that I'm running is because of the city service. We have no aldermen in 36th Ward. The remaps were done in 2010. They're approved by the courts in 2012. And ever since then, the former alderman of several wards that now encompasses the 36th went like this. And when you would call, and our neighbors would call them, they said, you know, you're not part of our ward anymore. You got to call the new guy. And the new guy, you know, they would call over there like, no, that's in 2015. Unfortunately, we can't handle that. And so who all lost out was us. And so a lot of people reached out to me because they knew of my work for Congresswoman Duckworth. They knew of my work in the state. And they said, Omar, I'm asking for a simple thing, a garbage can. I call 311. It's been weeks. What do I do? Who do I go to? Which one is my alderman? What ward am I in? I was like, well, technically, they're kind of both right, they're kind of both wrong, but that's the problem. And then the thing is that my education is on criminal justice, and I'm a big believer of the broken windows theory. When a community doesn't look and well prepared, it's not that there's people within that community that are criminals, it's that you have criminal elements that come and say, well, if they're not taking care of that broken window, then they don't really pay attention. Well, we're a working class community. So sometimes it's harder for the community to come together. So I will, and I'm glad that Gilbert has started taking services. We've been doing that since May, since I've started knocking on doors. We've been taking care of complaints.
Thank you. Now we're gonna be moving to the 26th Ward, and we have Brian Herrera.
How's it going? My name is Brian Herrera. I am an 18-year-old graphic designer, artist, and local community activist. And my question regards gentrification and housing stability. So now I have a little statement that I'd like you guys to hear first. So in the past year, Hermosa has been the topic of newspaper articles saying it could be the next and upcoming neighborhood in Chicago because of its proximity to the new Bloomingdale Trail Park. Now, already, there's already a speculation that is driving on property values and taxes in Hermosa, as well as encouraging unscrupulous developers and real estate agents to prey on longtime homeowners. The Hermosa Community Network and the Logan Square Neighborhood Association are discussing ways to protect the stability of homeowners, small buildings, and owners and tenants. Meanwhile, it appears that the city of Chicago will have to raise taxes soon to pay its pension obligations. Now we have a two-part question. First of all, do you oppose increasing property taxes? And second of all, what other kinds of taxes do you support so that we can avoid increasing property taxes?
Hello. This is a great question from an 18-year-old kid. First of all, I don't believe that increasing taxes and you know basically taxpayers should be paying for these balloon pensions. Okay, we keep hitting the middle class, and the middle class keep paying more taxes, higher taxes on gas, water bottles, and we just can't afford. You know, I talked to a lot of people, and they feel like they want to get out of this city. Why? Because of the taxes. There's other ways, avenues that we can raise taxes before we start increasing taxes into the middle class. I proposed the gaming industry. As long as there's control, we can bring some casinos. We can go like Atlanta or other states. We can bring those casinos into separate hotels throughout the city of Chicago, as long as there's control, okay? I also, a lot of people keep talking about LaSalle tax. LaSalle tax is a great way to venue to bring more money into the city to balance those pensions. People just, these millionaires, the billionaires, they keep through transactions year after year, they keep making these millions of dollars and they're not paying their fair tax into our city of Chicago. Other things that I can create, if I come to be the alderman, I'm gonna, be a strong voice in the city council to bring the what they call those guys that go outside the. Seemed like I didn't get a fair time, but.
Thank you for this great question. Issues of gentrification and housing stability hit very close to home for me and are very close to my heart. I've spent most of my life working in affordable housing and community development issues, from affordable rental housing to homeownership issues. And so that's the expertise I bring to the community and look forward to working with you on these issues. I actually also happen to live on the block of Bloomingdale Trail, so I understand the challenges of those prices very much going up and community residents being moved out. My own parents ended up moving out by Armitage and Kildare here a number of years back because back in their place in Logan Square, the rent went overnight from $500 to $1,200. My parents on their fixed income most certainly could not afford that kind of spike in rent. So these are really important issues. I'm very much against property tax hikes that hit the lowest and moderate income families in our community. Many folks have owned their home for years but end up getting displaced because they've already even paid off their house in many cases but now cannot afford their property taxes. They're a regressive form of tax which I oppose. I also oppose the gaming which was just talked about because in running a foreclosure prevention program I've watched families lose their home because of their gambling problems. I think that's just another kind of regressive tax. I would focus much more on the issues of sales taxes and services that are not being put forth in Illinois, where in other states we're putting sales taxes when people buy luxury boats and when people doing legal, when legal services are being taxed. There are a whole bunch of kinds of taxes that hit the upper and upper middle class folks that are not being imposed here in Illinois, and that would be a much more progressive way to address the taxes.
It is true that the threat of gentrification is very real. 10 years ago, we saw it in Humboldt Park, and then we were hit with a recession, and there was a slowdown in the pace of gentrification in Humboldt Park. Since 2012, the pace of gentrification in Humboldt Park has been fast growing, very, very fast. And yes, it is going and it's coming north of Bloomingdale, hitting Hermosa, and there is no doubt about that. What can we do to slow down gentrification? One of the things that we can do, one of the things that I've done in the 26th Ward is that every single lot owned by the city of Chicago, it is being put aside so that middle-class families, families of four making not more than $90,000 a year, can buy a property for not more than $200,000. Now, I've been fought by members of the eastern part of the ward because there are 7 lots there and they live on $1 million plus homes and they don't want these $200,000 being built next to theirs. I think that they are misguided. I think that the right public policy to pursue is that if we have public land, let's bring and let's use it to bring about economic diversity.
Now we're moving to the last question. Question number 8. And we have, this is going to go to the 31st ward, and we have Jesus Velasquez.
Hi, my name is Jesus Velasquez. My bad, I'm short. I'm really short. So I attend Kelvin Park High School, and the reason why I'm here is because I see a lot of new money being put into the schools, but the actual way the schools look, instead of getting like tools for teachers. And we have two questions. The first one is, as alderman, what would you do to get better resources for the teachers, elective classes and extracurricular programs in our school? And my second question is, would you support a freeze on any new charter schools in order to help everyone focus more on the efforts of strengthening our neighborhood schools such as Kelvin Park? This goes to the 31st ward candidate.
Yes.
A good question. Thank you for
the microphone.
It's got my hand.
Very, very good question. Well, first of all, we have to get more dollars into the schools, and I agreed. I just bought $9.2 million last year to take Kelvin Park High School and change it from a full high school. It'll also have, as you know, seventh and eighth graders, and we remodeled that section to keep the eighth graders away from the upper classes, but they're gonna be in contact with each other. We brought in an entire new security system in that place, all new cameras, a brand new backup generator, and the school is looking great. We need to make sure that, and I've talked to the principal, and she tells me that they have enough resources right now to take care of the demands of what they're looking for. Now, you're telling me something different. I'm more than happy to meet with you privately to find out what you're talking about in terms of the needs of Kelvin Park High School. Kelvin Park High School, in my opinion, is going to be a great school because now we have a seventh and eighth grade program at Kelvin Park High School, which is not restricted to anybody, whoever wants to go there. And we have a 9, 10, 11, and 12th high school also dedicated to graduating and making sure that our kids come out and will be the role models of this great city. But, you know, everybody says bring money, and I agree we should bring money. But also we need to make sure that we have a commitment from moms and dads to be part of the system so we can get our children graduating and making sure that they're gonna be the stars of our community, which we want.
Hi, yeah, this is an excellent question. I've made the public schools the center of my campaign. They're the thing that I know the most about in terms of all the issues that affect Hermosa and all four of the wards that are here. My wife's a CPS teacher, my mom's a CPS teacher. I'm the only independent progressive candidate in the 31st ward who's running in the 31st ward who's qualified to talk about this. The two candidates, one on my left and one on my right, have both taken money from pro-charter school organizations. They both are supported by people that support Rahm Emanuel. Rahm Emanuel is telling a bogus narrative to the people of the city of Chicago. It's a tale of two cities. He's systematically working to improve the lakefront and the loop and decrease funding to the public neighborhood schools in the neighborhoods. When I'm elected, I'm going to advocate fully for the Chicago public neighborhood schools. On Friday night, I was at a bar and I met with 10 Kelvin Park teachers who were so excited to hear that I was running, so excited to know that somebody who cares about the public schools, who's put the public schools as their most fundamental, most important cog in their platform, was running in the 31st ward. A lot of the money that the alderman talks about that's been brought into Kelvin Park High School is ADA money that the federal government required CPS to spend to make improvements for wheelchairs and accessibility. It's not money that he made a phone call and said, hey, we need more money. When I'm elected, I will work with the principal, with the teachers, and with the students. I was knocking on doors, and two Kelvin Park students came up to me and said, "What are you doing?" And I told them, they said, "Can we volunteer for you?" And on the spot, they went for like 6 or 7 blocks from me knocking on doors. Thank you.
That is an excellent question. I've lived in the 31st Ward for 31 years exactly, and my two daughters are product of CPS. And I, when I was a reporter, I covered CPS most of the time, as well as City Hall. So I'm pretty knowledgeable about what's happening with the situation with public schools. And you know, I'm surprised to hear that the alderman has been, you know, putting up here Kelvin Park, when I know for a fact that Kelvin Park has been in remediation for a long time. So instead of bringing money to the school without really trying to come up with a comprehensive plan to get those kids into college and to bring resources for the school, or maybe be more accountable about, you know, how the administration is running that school. I mean, it's something very serious. I've known about 3 or 4 different principals and from Kelvin Park, and you know what? It's been very tough for that school. So, you know, I am also a very independent person. I am a very progressive person, and when I'm elected to city council, I'm going to be independent, and I thank the support that I've been getting for different organizations and from different elected officials, because that means that there is some respect for my candidacy and my ability to lead. So one of the things that I really want to try to do is bring the community together, engage the parents into being more proactive with their kids, and bring a lot of resources so that they can also be part of the changes of the future of our generation. Thank you.
Okay, we completed the second round, and we're going to be moving to the third round and to the open statements or final statements. Now each candidate and alderman will have 2 minutes to address any issue that is or your liking, to address any issue or statement made by another candidate. We're not going to be debating, but you will be able to address it in the way that you want in these next 2 minutes. And we're going to be moving with the 35th Ward now, and we're going to be having Mr. Rick Colon.
Thank you. Well, I did want to, there were questions that were asked in other wards that I wanted to speak to. One was really just talking about, well, first of all, the neighborhood and young people. One of the things that I did before becoming alderman is that I was the director of the Logan Square Boys and Girls Club. I also raised money to build the McCormick Tribune YMCA on Lawndale and Cortland. And I always was the area manager for the Chicago Park District. And I bring those things up because working with young people, for me, my goal has always been to make sure that I create a community that's safe and healthy for young people. And that's what I've done in my community, in my ward, in my 12 years, and it's what I really want to focus my attention on now. You know, I was very fortunate when I opened the YMCA to bring in the Miracle Center, who didn't have a home at that time and who now resides and works in Hermosa, and I worked with them to put them together with the folks who are renovating the Disney Birthplace home to make sure that we have some creative opportunities for our young people in Hermosa. And it's what I'd like to continue to do in my service as alderman. The other thing is that with regards to empty storefronts and economic development, I worked very closely with the art community and tried to work with artists and businesses to create a neighborhood that was not only helping to expand the local businesses, but also bringing in and creating new businesses that incorporated the culture of the neighborhood. And in areas where we had empty storefronts, we actually made galleries and made the block more inviting and more attractive to look at so that people can come into the neighborhood. Also, just with regards to infrastructure, since I've been an alderman, you know, I've been bringing in lots of dollars for infrastructure work, for water main projects, for improving the Blue Line station. We got $500 million that's going into improving our transportation system. And all these different things really add to making the neighborhood safe and wholesome and wanting people to come in and invest in the area. So if reelected in the 35th Ward, I'd like to take some of the success from the old ward and bring it into the new. Thank you.
Now we have Carlos Rosa.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your time. You know, I'm running for alderman because I love Chicago, right? I lived off of Wellington Avenue most of my life. And I'm running because at the same time, as much as I love Chicago, I'm tired of the direction that we're going in, right? I'm tired of seeing potholes not being fixed for years. I'm tired of seeing schools without libraries or air conditioning, while at the same time we're giving our public tax dollars to big corporations and big campaign contributors. I'm tired of a status quo that puts powerful interests first and our families last. You know, in Logan Square, you know, the heart of the 35th Ward, 10,000 low-income Latino families have had to leave that neighborhood in the last 10 years because of rising rents, because of deals that were cut behind their back. My commitment is to the people who pay my paycheck, not the people who donate to my campaign. My commitment is to the families right here. And so when I'm alderman right here in Hermosa, you're gonna get tired of seeing me because I'm gonna be knocking your door all the time. But in case you don't catch me, I don't catch you at the door, you're gonna be able to see me on Armitage Avenue because I'm gonna open an office with State Senator Willie Delgado right there, kitty corner from the Walgreens down the street. So you're gonna see me knocking block to block, you're gonna see me hands-on because that's the type of person that I am. I've been working to put our families first as a congressional caseworker, helping immigrant families facing deportation, helping senior citizens facing foreclosure. I've been working as a community organizer, helping our families with legal issues that they're facing. So I've dedicated my life to public service, to putting our families first. And that's exactly what I'm gonna keep doing as alderman, so that there's no question who your alderman is accountable to, because you'll know that I'm on your side, right? And if you don't believe it, you're gonna be able to ask me when I'm at your door, right? Not just during election time, but in the fall, in the winter, in the summer. So if you want a neighborhood where you know that you're in charge, where you have participatory budgeting and you're getting to decide how to spend those 1.3 million infrastructure funds, if you want a neighborhood that is being invested in and isn't paying out big corporations, then I hope I can earn your vote on February 24th. Thank you.
Now we're moving to the 26th Ward. Adam.
Hello, hello. Again, thank you for giving the opportunity to express my concerns and my platform. I was born and raised in Mexico. I came in the age of 22, graduated from University of Mexico, and I fell in love with this city Chicago. I started making $60 a week back in the 80s, believe it or not. And I'm at this point in my life that everything I have accomplished is because of the hard work, dedication, perseverance, and ethic work. And this is what I want to be doing for you guys. If you guys elect me, I want to be a strong voice in city council. I don't want to be a rubber stamp like some aldermen. Okay, that's first of all. One thing, I'm gonna represent the community, work for the community, and not for my personal interest like some aldermen there. Second of all, my platform comes about schools. Schools, there's no more closing the schools. I'm against charter schools. For those that they are here, they're questioning me. I'm here for the public schools. I have not taken money from, you know, I would not take money like some aldermen have taken money from those PACs that they overseen those charter schools. Not only $10,000, but $25,000. Me, I'm gonna donate 5% of my salary, and I can sign a pledge and raise my hand. I will donate 5% of my salary for the first term for the public schools in the 26th Ward. And you can call me accountable for that. I don't wanna be a career politician. I don't have politicians whispering in my ear what is gonna be my next move. I've been independent from the beginning of my campaign. I've been working hard, I've been knocking on doors, and this is what you're gonna see out there. A guy that is gonna be rolls his sleeves, is gonna get dirty, is gonna get back to work, okay? Because sitting in your office, you're not gonna accomplish anything. So again, I hope you hello, 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 oh. You know, I'm also a ward superintendent for the 45th ward. I want to bring those services into this 26th ward and work, you know, along with the other wards that are surrounded by me. So I need about 10, 15 minutes for me to tell you my platform. This is what I'm going to do.
Now we have Juanita.
Okay.
Thank you very much. My candidacy really flows out of my lifetime of life and service in the community. I grew up in Logan Square in Humboldt Park and have lived for 40 years within walking distance of every place I've ever lived in that community. I also went to Kelvin Park High School. So I have a really special heart for this community of Hermosa because this has been part of my own journey. And as I mentioned, my parents lived down the street as well, having been displaced from Logan Square because of the issues that we've talked about today. It was actually the closure of Ames Middle School and its conversion into a military academy by the incumbent alderman of the 26th Ward that really was the final straw that led to me jumping into this race. I actually got calls from many people throughout the community, including folks from Kelvin Park's local school council, concerned about the impact that that change would have on their own school. So I'm very excited to have responded to that call to address these issues. My parents are both teachers. My brother is a Chicago Public School teacher and a CTU member, and I've been endorsed by the Chicago Public School, by the Chicago Teachers Union, because of my commitment to investing in our neighborhood schools and making sure that all kids in our community have a good school in their neighborhood that they can walk to and not have to go out throughout the city to find other options. As I've mentioned, my expertise really is in housing and community development. I ran a nonprofit organization whose focus was housing policy. I've worked for three different nonprofit community development corporations, so I very much would be excited to work with this community to address the property tax issues, the foreclosure challenges, the tenant displacement issues. Going beyond my nonprofit work, I worked in philanthropy where I had the chance to help give away super rich people's money to nonprofit organizations and help to fund groups like the Metropolitan Tenants Organization, Logan Square Neighborhood Association, Spanish Coalition for Housing, all of whom are impacting the issues you've talked about here today. I also helped to fund arts through Segundo Ruiz Belvis Cultural Center, early childhood through Family Focus, serving this community as well. I will bring an independent spirit to this community and fight back against the parking meters and red light scandals that we've already discussed. Thank you.
When you see a school in a community that was on probation for 12 years out of the 14 years of existence, I mean, that cry for a change. It cried for a drastic change. Ames was a middle school where 12 and 13 years old kids have to go through metal detectors to go to the school. That is wrong. I cannot imagine that any of the parents sitting here would imagine or would think of any of your kids in middle school having to go through metal detectors to go to their schools. That's why it took me 4.5 years to push and persuade, and some groups were against it, but we have now the Marine Leadership Institute, 7 through 12, where 94% of those graduates are admitted to a four-year college. Four-year college. We cannot say the same thing about Kelvin Park. We cannot say the same thing about Kelvin Park. Lafayette was the only 16 years in a row, on probation. Kids now go walk two blocks east to Chopin to a level one school. Level one, where 100% of those kids are admitted to Whitney Young when they graduate from eighth grade. Now we have two high schools, and we don't have to experiment with a new innovative model with our students to see if it works in 4 years down the road. And on Lafayette, we have Shy Arts, the only public performing arts high school in the city of Chicago. So if you want more of the same, failing our kids, you have other choices. If you want a leader that stands for change to improve the quality of education of our kids, this is your candidate. Thank you.
Thank you for being here tonight. Good evening. I was born in Puerto Rico, raised in Chicago. I'm a former Marine, Vietnam veteran. And I've always been committed to making sure that the quality of education in our community improves. I brought $140 million to the school system. This gentleman says there was special money. And tell me how Northwest Grand High School was built.
Tell me how the additions at Nixon were built. I was the one that helped put that addition there. So if you don't know what you're talking about, you got to make sure that you get the facts correctly. I will continue to fight for reasonable class sizes. And let me tell you, in the 31st Ward, there was no charter schools. I don't have a charter school. But I'll tell you what, I'm a guy that's I'm against busing. And if I can save 500 kids to stay in my community, I would consider a charter school. Because when we send them out on a bus, we lose control of our children. And we have to make sure that we fight for good schools and keep them in our community. And I believe education starts in our community. Keeping our community safe is also my priority. In the 31st Ward, crime has, compared for last year, has gone down 27%. 27%. Building, economic development. I brought over 2,200 jobs to this ward. 2,200. The Macy property that's over here called the old Marshall Field Building alone will bring 1,600 new jobs to this community. And people can find a job and go to work and enjoy working safe in their community. Transportation, we're gonna remodel the Healy Station and the North Grand Cicero Station. I helped remodel that station about 5 years ago when it was nobody wanted to go in there. And in terms of building homes for the seniors, I'm on my fourth senior home. It's going to be built on George and Cicero. And let me tell you something. 70 new seniors will be able to live safe in a clean place and comfortably. And that's going to be heated by thermal heating. The bill for the energy will go down. I'm telling you, I deliver. I've always delivered. And not about the people that are running against me. I like talking. They don't talk about the facts. They just talk. They just talk.
Hi, my name is Sean Starr, and I'm running to move the 31st Ward forward. I'm a lawyer and a college professor by trade, but more importantly than that, I'm a husband and I'm a dad. My wife and I have lived in Logan Square for 15 years. We decided to put roots down, and we bought a house in the 31st Ward. I was raised on the city's northwest side in a working-class family. My parents instilled in me the idea that if I worked hard, I could make something of myself, and I have. I put myself through undergrad, graduate school, and law school. I want to be able to tell my daughter, honestly tell my daughter, that same thing. And I'm running in large part because the mayor and the vast majority of City Hall and the vast majority of the incumbent aldermen have systematically been working against the middle and working class people of the city of Chicago. You know, if I'm elected, I will be an advocate for the middle class families in the 31st Ward and in the wards in the neighborhoods that are collar counties or collar neighborhoods to the 31st Ward. I'm the most qualified independent candidate. I can't say the only progressive candidate here because Irma just walked in, and I have to acknowledge her. My two political machine opponents are being supported by Rahm Emanuel. Alderman Suarez has decency to admit it. I'm backing Chuy Garcia. Chuy Garcia is running a pro-progressive campaign that's going to put the neighborhoods and the working class people in this community first, over the lakefront, over the loop, over the mayor's systematic attack on the working class. You know, just to answer the question that I didn't fully answer before, I'm against charter schools. I understand, as a parent, I understand the appeal of alternatives. And I know that there's great teachers at charter schools and great ideas at charter schools. But when you make public education a private commodity, what you do is you invest on the return and not the education of our children. And we have to fight for our neighborhood public schools. When I'm elected, I'm going to be a full-time advocate for the 31st Ward and a full-time advocate in the city council for the Chicago Public Schools. You know, take a look at my website. I'm clear on all the issues. Thank you.
This has been such a great opportunity for us to present what we really want to offer for our own communities. Like I said, I've been living in the 31st Ward for 31 years as a homeowner, and I raised my two daughters here. And I have the heart in my community. And I've always fought for the community. I've been a public servant, and I was born to serve from the heart. I have no interest in being popular or famous, or I'm not interested in a title or a big check. I've been in this ward, and I've been talking to my families, and I've been covering the news here that continue to be exactly the same issues. On public safety, I want to be able to empower and engage our parents and our community into being the ears and the eyes of each of the streets of our ward. You know, it's very unfortunate that sometimes we live in an area or in a street and we don't even know who our next door neighbor is. I want to be able to create an environment of families. I also have as a priority Chicago Public Schools. I support my local schools first. I am not in favor of charter schools because I believe that if money has been allocated to open more charter schools, the same money should be coming to the public schools. Yeah. And the same resources should be coming to the public schools and the teachers and the children that need so much help. I consider myself independent because when I am elected, I don't want to be a rubber stamp, as my dear vice mayor is. He has voted 98% in favor of the mayor. And then we have been seeing so many projects coming to the 31st Ward and people don't even know until a building is up. This thing about Macy's, you know, it's very unfortunate because I never got a letter saying that you're welcome to come to a meeting and discuss what's coming here. So this is what I'm standing for. I am an independent person and I'm for the people and I will continue to be.
So I'm Irma Cornier. I'm actually running on 31st Ward as well. I am a progressive, as Sean stated earlier. The reason why I wasn't here was because a dear friend, family friend, was shot and killed. Okay? My importance is my community. I've been in my community for quite a long time. For me, I'm tired of the gang violence. Okay, you want to know information about me? Google me. Irma Cornier. I'm not going to stay here and I'm going to stand saying I'm here for like the school board. That information is already there. What I want to do is I want to have my community center. I want to have the student intervention youth program. I want to reintegrate that used to exist here a long time ago once we had a YMCA on Central Park and Fullerton. Once that YMCA, you remember that YMCA? You're from the neighborhood. You are from the neighborhood. I'm from this neighborhood. I know my area really, really well. I've been here for over 20 years, okay? And this 13-year-old boy was shot and killed at the street corner where we were at. That's probably gonna take over the news tonight. What I want to do is, with this gang intervention program, I'm going to talk to these gangs. I'm going to try to do what my dear friend used to do when he was the director of the YMCA and of this respective program. You remember who the director is, right? A good friend? He's a pastor now. So what I come from the faith-based organizations. We're the community leaders. We're the ones that have been taking care of the neighborhood. We're the ones that actually care. We're the ones that know what it's really about. I'm not a talker, I'm a mover, okay? I'm not one of these people that's gonna talk. No, I don't believe in that. You have to make change, you have to do change, and you have to walk that walk. I come from a long line of community activists. I come from a long line of faith-based people, and we do what we say we're gonna do.
So I served the last 2 years on the Kelvin Park High School local school council, and I remember calling Juanita when Ames closed because I knew it was going to affect my high school. I remember seeing Irma come into the school at an LSC meeting and speak to us. What I don't remember is Millie Santiago walking in there during those 2 years ever. So I just wanted to clarify that, right? Because we do have a lot of Kelvin Park students here, and they saw how hard they fought alongside me to make sure that school was taken care of. I'm not going to spend the next 2 minutes promoting my campaign. You just have to Google my name and the name of the other candidates on this at this table, and you'll see a history of service in the community, not just when they started knocking on doors to run for office. But I've been organizing in our community, in this community, since I was 15. I didn't just move into our neighborhood, just like two of these candidates here 2 years ago, just to run. They call themselves progressive and independent. Why didn't they get endorsed by the IVIPO and the NDFA like I did, right? I've taken no money from any politicians, from special interest groups, or even businesses. This is a grassroots campaign. On the other hand, State Rep Arroyo, who is present with his son here, donated $30,000 to both Millie Santiago and to Gilbert Villegas. You read the facts. Can I get more time? Can I get more time?
Yes.
The money you gave her. Yeah. I have a different definition of what a progressive is. Now, you got a choice here. You got to choose somebody as a voter who's going to fight for you. Are you going to choose somebody who's a machine politician that just appeared last year? Are you going to choose somebody to work for you who's been working for you and fighting for you his entire life? It's an option that you have. If you don't choose to take it, if 4 years from now you come over here to this, to a similar event and you regret your vote, well, that's on you.
So again, thank you all for coming out. I'm very honored to be here and be part of this process. Again, my name is Chris Vittorio. I am running for alderman in the 36th Ward. I am a lifetime resident of this ward. My wife is also a lifetime resident. We just purchased our third home in the ward. I have two children, and our plan is simple. We want to raise our kids and spend the rest of our lives here. I am a business owner. I started my company in 1998. Over the last 17 years, I've maintained exceptional growth. I've added 4 employees. I'm adding 2 more this year. I am an independent. There is no one involved in my campaign. I am beholden to no one. I'm running for alderman because, like a lot of you, I'm sick and tired of what's going on at City Hall. I'm tired of having to beg for city services. The condition of our ward is absolutely horrific. Most importantly, I'm sick and tired of machine politicians and their self-serving decisions that have caused every problem we face. My vision, my background, the qualities that I bring earned me the endorsement from the Chicago Sun-Times, and I'll make you this promise. If you give me this opportunity, I will always advocate for what's best for our community. I will always tell you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear, and the Chris Vittorio you see here tonight is going to be the same Chris Vittorio in 4 years. I'll be that same Chris Vittorio in 8 years. This will not change me. It's time for all of us, every ward here tonight, to take control of our own destiny. Look at the map. Look at what's going on. This is not for your benefit. It's for theirs. So we need to start electing independents that are a true voice for each ward. And I hope to have the opportunity to serve you.
Ray, there's no such thing as a former Marine. Once a Marine, always a Marine. As a Marine Corps veteran who fought for this country, what I'm going to do is bring that same fight to City Hall to make sure that the residents of the 36th Ward are getting the services they need. I used to be a Teamster union steward. I represented drivers and dock workers who fought for those rights. As a former deputy director of the Illinois Department of Transportation, I oversaw billions of dollars in contracts to make sure that minority and women-owned businesses, small businesses, were participating on federal and state projects. I made sure that everyone was at the table. I used to run an association called HACIA, Hispanic American Construction Industry Association, where I represented over 300 companies. I introduced legislation, drafted it, and made sure they got passed into law. I'm the only candidate that can say that. As it relates after 3 years with HACIA, I became the chief of staff at the Capital Development Board, where I oversaw 140 people in a $3.9 billion capital program successfully. Okay, I've always advocated for the little guy, made sure that small businesses, minority-owned businesses were participating on contracts. After 3 years there, I started my own business. I have a consulting company where I help small and mid-sized companies penetrate both the private and public sectors. Okay. These gentlemen here want to talk about machine politics. There's only one candidate here that's a machine politic, and that's Omar Aquino. Okay, the reality is this. When you have the executive director of the Cook County Democratic Party running his campaign, that's an issue. When you have tax attorneys that are donating to his campaign, that's an issue. He has a progressive tax swap. That means your taxes are going up $646 per household in perpetuity. Do the math. Don't be fooled, ladies and gentlemen. We need experience. We have a librarian, a DJ, and we have an unemployed young man looking for a job. I'm telling you right now, this is about experience, and this is about making sure that we're sending the right people to the 36th Ward.
You know, so my name is Omar Aquino, and I'm running for alderman in the 36th Ward. And unlike unlike Gilbert, I'm not going to start attacking him. There's a lot of things that that you can research on Gilbert, and there's a lot of questionable things in his past, but I don't need to do that, because at the end of the day, that doesn't do anything for you. It doesn't make our streets any safer. It doesn't fill in a pothole. It doesn't get any of our city services. But if that's the type of campaign he wants to run, if he's afraid that a quote-unquote unemployed person's going to I'm not unemployed. I left my job working for Congresswoman Tammy Duckworth, the thing that I didn't have to do because I have a great respect for. I love serving on her staff. I decided to run for office because we were ignored. My community, I lived in the 37th ward, and we didn't have an alderman once these maps were done. The old alderman just said, you're not part of my ward anymore. The new one that he has the support of knew that he was going to run in the 38th ward. He made that announcement in August, but we've known for several years, because when you would call and ask for services, like, you know what? I don't understand the issues of Grand and Pulaski. I don't know what those people want. Well, the war doesn't actually go to Grand Pulaski, but we want the same thing anybody else wants. We pay taxes, just like anyone else, just like Lincoln Park, just like on the east side of the city. But yet, where are the services when we request them? We can call 311, do all that, but your alderman's office, which should be a full-time job, Gilbert, a full-time job, that's who you call for to make sure those things get done. So that's why I'm running. I want to make sure that city services are taken care of. I want to make sure that we are actually doing something about our public safety. It is, and remember, I'm not doing this for credit. I just want to say it is a shame that happened. I apologize. My condolences to your friends and your family. But one life is too many. I know it is. I know it is. And I talked to Alonzo about the possibility of us four going there. But I want to respect the family's space. I didn't want us to get on TV with, you know. So I want to just say that I'm not going to go around attacking people, because that's not going to do anything for you.
Thank you. Wow. I thought that 13 candidates, we will be here until midnight. We did it. And we still have time to spare. So you, all of you, or whoever wants, can come and meet the candidates and ask your personal questions. Now, I want to thank you. I want to thank our aldermen, current, Ray Colon, Ray Suarez, and Maldonado. I want to thank the 10 candidates for our Hermosa community. Now the job is in your hands. Now the job, today started early voting. I hope that the Hermosa Community Network hopes that this forum was of help to you, that you were able to get out of here more informed and understand better the issues of the community, the concerns of the neighbors, and also how the candidates can come together to work together for a better Hermosa community.